We've actually got some recaps this week. Two things officially premiered. C.H. Greenblatt's new join on Nickelodeon, Harvey Beaks, and the official premiere of Star vs. the Forces of Evil, but that's not what, like, I don't know what official means in this context, because it's the third episode.
I don't know anymore. Television is...
Well, actually, weird. No. Technically, it's the second episode. The thing that was on Disney XD officially airs next week. Whatever. Fuck it. What do you want to talk about first? I think Star will be quicker to get out of the way.
Yeah.
Okay.
Because I feel like people already know about Star. Beaks is, like, brand spanking new.
Yeah. Star continues to be, I think, just really funny, really high energy.
Really mesmerizing to watch. Like, the lip flaps, of all things,
yeah,
captivate me.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, there's a lot going on there.
Very visually appealing show in every way.
Oh, yeah, it's an episode. The first one is about Star accidentally transforming their math teacher into a troll, and then having to deal with that. And then the second part was about Star misunderstanding football, and how the rival football team has always destroyed their school's team, and so she, like, militarizes the football field.
Yeah, they use the word slaughter, and she takes it very literally, so...
My favorite goof was the one where she was talking about how she was raised by, like,
the Imperial Guard.
The yep. Imperial Guard. And the guy was, like, demonstrating with her teddy bear about, you know, you wait for it to snap, and that's how you know you didn't. Like, just adorable baby Star being like, yeah! Like, and pigtails, like, so cute.
Like, I like the bit with the cheerleaders when she asks them what their plan is, and they're just like, we're just gonna shake it, and then she's, like, looking at them aghast and horrified, and she's just like, do you know nothing of combat?
I was like, you're not gonna have to distract anybody with Cecilia's butt. Hey!
It was just really funny and really sweet and just cheered me up. Yep. I don't know.
And one of Marco's two weird friends, Ferguson and Alfonso, I assume Alfonso is voiced by Matt Chapman. I'm like 0 for 12 now. Fuck. So I'm really liking it. Like, the first episode I saw, I'm like, this is good. This is fun, but, like, kind of insubstantial. And then after the second episode, I'm like, okay, this is actually pretty funny.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, it's very funny. I'm not expecting it to be, like, any show to have, like, this grand overarching plot or mystery or whatever, which is what people have come to expect now with, like, Adventure Time and Gravity Falls and Steven and stuff, but that doesn't have to be the norm. You can just have a really well-put-together, fun show that's cute and well-written with enjoyable characters.
Like Wander. That's what Wander is. There's no mythos to Wander.
Not really.
Ah, yes, the vast Wander canon.
And actually, in a very similar vein, is this new show, Harvey Beaks, which I really liked.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, it is really, really sweet.
The music! Out of control! I've never heard that kind of shit in TV. And especially all the music is that kind of, like, crazy montage, like, super cheerful montage tone. Like, normally...
Yeah.
Oh, it's so good.
It's, like, attacking your heartstrings with, like, music that's, like, appealing to your inner child and, like, wonder and love and, like... The scene where they're falling off the tree.
Oh, it's beautiful.
And the it's absolutely gorgeous. Like, it filled my soul up with just pure joy. And I was just like, oh, this is exactly what life is all about. And it's captured on the cartoon. And so sweet. Like, there's something weirdly, like, profound about it, even though it's very simple. It's just the way it's directed and handled, like, these very particular scenes that are just so... Ooh. And then there are other scenes that are your, you know, typical fun goofy times, like when Harvey starts stripping off his clothes and screaming a lot. But, you know, it's a balance.
This is every Wednesday night for me.
Yeah. The character of Harvey kind of resonated with me a lot, because what's interesting about him is that he's a very well-liked, well-respected kid. He's a good kid. But he feels like he's being held back by how much of a good kid he is. So he's trying to go outside his comfort zone and be kind of like a more of a troublemaker, more of a bad kid, so that he can open this stuff up to him. And it's completely not him, and nobody's asking him to do it.
No.
You know, his you know, more troublemaker friends, they're honestly not pressuring him to do it, really.
No.
Yeah, they're very sweet.
But this is like this complex he's created, and that resonates with me on a personal level.
Yeah, me too, honestly. Like, I didn't do much of anything.
I was trying
to
be a good kid.
Yeah. I just was by default, and so I never really got any opportunity because I just never put myself in any sort of situation for anything like that. I admire Harvey. I didn't even go as far as him.
Yeah.
I was just like, this is fine. I'll just stay here.
I love how a lot of the characters are voiced by kids, and they're like really good kid voices. Yeah. Like some of them are very funny, like the bear. That bear kid.
Techno Bear.
I love Techno Bear.
God. And then the rabbit.
Princess is hilarious. The rabbit.
The rabbit's voiced by Greenblatt.
Yeah.
As is the Mushroom Man.
Yeah. I feel like what surprised me was most of the cast, the three main characters, they're all voiced by like legitimate actual children.
Yeah, and they do a good job. And Harvey is so lovable.
Yeah.
Like he's instantly lovable. His design is one of my favorite designs to come out. Like. In a while, like, just, it's so cute and so solid.
It's so simple. They remind me of Muppets or like Fraggles.
Yeah, they're very Henson-ish.
Yeah, I mean, and obviously, you know, we saw a similar character design coming out of Chowder.
Yeah.
This
is different because, like, I never watched that much Chowder, but Chowder was more like weird Muppet men, and these are more like dumb animal characters.
Yeah, yeah.
These totally. Are far more
like,
animal.
The rabbit is like some of them wear clothing. The rabbit is literally a big fluffy bunny. Techno Bear has some tight Speed. Shorts. Yeah.
Princess has a dress.
Princess. I forgot about Princess.
How did you forget about
Princess? I also love Princess's dad.
Oh, with the crystals. The
crazy crystal guy.
Yeah, actual doctor with crystals. Oh, crystals are such bullshit.
They are.
Yeah. The only thing that like sort of bothered me was that like all the characters were animals except for Fee and Foo, which I'm looking up. They are imps, I guess.
Huh.
Yeah.
Neat.
So...
Well, I mean, they've established that it's a fantasy world. They have some crazy water dragon lake guardian. Yeah. So.
And the mushroom.
We'll see more of it, I'm sure. Yeah.
Yeah, because really the only other character, I guess, was the Mushroom Man that wasn't, like, a aminal.
It's almost like, you know, in fairy tales when you'll have, like, talking animals show up and interact with the humans. It's literally just, like, what these guys do in their off time.
Yeah. Oh, I loved how, I loved how Harvey's dad also had a baby Bjorn, but with an egg.
Yeah.
It was really cute.
And, like, the backgrounds have an interesting look to them.
Oh, my God. The backgrounds are so gorgeous.
The spinning tree half I was only able to see on my phone, so I couldn't get as good of a look at them. But, yeah, like, it's very much like Greenblatt's style of, like, putting like an odd look to his cartoons, but in a way that's a lot less distracting than the thing from Chowder, which I like.
Yeah, Chowder used a lot of pattern.
That like pattern layered thing where the patterns
the pattern was stationary.
It's an interesting look, but I found it very distracting.
I've seen it used other places in small doses, but C.H. Greenblatt must have just been like, we're just fucking doing it. Yeah. Every fucking filling thing is getting, like, get that fucking paint bucket hotkey ready. Going nuts.
Yeah.
So this show is going to be airing every Saturday. Nickelodeon. So far, they've got lined up so that, you know, no hiatuses going all throughout April and into May.
And we're
going
to get two segments each time.
Yes. I don't know what the time slot is, though.
Let's see if I can... Usually, if you Goog it, it'll just
fucking... Oh, wait, it's on Nickelodeon?
Yeah.
Yeah, they're awful with that. There's no way we're going to be able to find that shit out.
Now, half of the first episode was on Nick.com.
Yes.
It's the Pachu one, which I like. Both segments were great. I felt that was a stronger one.
Really? I really like Spitting Tree a lot.
I mean, yeah. Spitting Tree was the first one I saw, and then I watched Pachu. I like Spitting Tree a lot, and Pachu was super good too.
Okay. But I have a lot of hope in this show. I think Nickelodeon's got a real winner on their hands.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, this has a lot of potential.
Because I feel like especially with first with Adventure Time and then with Gravity Falls, I feel like Nickelodeon's really been freaking looking for something. Hopefully, this is it.
Yeah.
For their sake.
Yeah, they need this push. So yeah, let's move on to shoutouts. You got a lot this week. You guys have been doing a great job participating and contacting us. So Lydia's Mediocre asked us, do you guys draw, by the way? Just wondering. Tooch, you draw, right?
Yes, I am an aspiring cartoonist. So I'm every week I come on the show to talk about stuff I would love to do for a living. And one of the reasons that the YouTube channel is taking so long to get going, because I've put all of my efforts besides doing this and looking for employment elsewhere at the moment, is working on a pitch for our buddies Cartoon Hangover, because they have an open door pitch policy. So I've been trying to crank something out for that.
We wish you luck, man.
Yeah, thanks.
Yeah, I haven't drawn in a really long time. I used to do it pretty frequently. I guess since coming to art school, I got kind of intimidated by it. But very recently, I sort of revisited my creative side. But I'm more into collages than drawing. Like, I like taking a bunch of shit and turning it into a new thing. So, yeah. There you go. Chald said, I love you.
I do not draw.
Yes, that's what
I've got
I'm
too much
sorry,
like anxiety, and I've got too much anxiety to learn.
Ah. Yeah. Chald said, I love you all so much. You're one of my favorite podcasts, and I'm so happy I found you. Thank you. I'm glad you found us too.
Yeah, thank you so much.
Yes.
Anonymous asked us, have you guys gotten any requests to talk about Code Lyoko?
I think we have.
Probably.
I don't think so. I think this is
our first
one.
Request to talk about Foreheads, the show.
I would be interested
Foreheads
in revisiting
in the Matrix.
I'd be interested in revisiting Foreheads,
yeah.
The show.
I doubt it's great, but there might be something there.
It's, I remember it vividly. But yeah, it's another one of those where the French tried to make anime. And,
And they already failed because they did it in 3D. Part of the way.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, yeah, but yeah, it was definitely an interesting concept, but the execution is very mediocre. It lasted a while. I think it got like 4 seasons, and by the 4th season, they had actually changed up the status quo somewhat, but then they just invented a new status quo.
I remember being pretty intrigued by it as a kid and trying to follow it.
Yeah, it's one of those where like the fan base is small and you just look at them and how dedicated they are for this small show that went nowhere, and you just go, you're breaking my heart, you guys. Because I think like they had a new series and I haven't checked in on it, but the non CG parts were live action. They decided to go this time.
Huh.
So yeah. I fell off with it the second I heard they were doing that, so I have no idea what's going on with it. If we do an episode on it, I'm sure we'll have to look into that. Whether or not we'll actually watch that, probably won't.
All right. We'll get back to you.
Keep your ears peeled.
Scar Farms said, "You guys were so right about the shrink and go into somebody's body trope. The latest episode of Archer just went there. No, I won't be able to not see it happening everywhere."
Yeah, yep. I'm behind on Archer. I can't believe they did that. That seems
you know
a that,
you
yeah.
know they must have mentioned it. You know that they were aware of that.
Yeah.
Girl of Swirl said, "Maybe you could watch Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles 2003 version, since it's the most criminally underrated series in the franchise." And also, I would recommend Redwall, since it has some good work in terms of story arcs and character development. I looked that up. It's based off a series of children's books.
I never read them, but I remember like a bunch of kids in my classes in elementary school reading them.
Yeah, they were in my library.
I'd be interested in checking that out.
I'd be interested in checking both of them. Like, I heard, Turtles 2003 goes to some weird and occasionally dumb places, but...
Oh, it does. I watched it, like, it was it got harder and harder to watch it in its later runs.
That's what this person says. For its first four seasons, it was amazing. So I guess later, they go to the future at some point.
That was like a spin, like that. That's what I mean. Like there was a couple spinoffs that are canon that they refer to. Like they had to change the name of the series a couple times because like the way they released it, it's like I don't even know. Just like distributing.
It's like there was Power Rangers, where every season it's like a different name.
No. It was just like there was a whole half season that never got aired on TV, and they had to release it on DVD as like the lost episodes. I'm talking about on a production and release and distribution level. It got fucked up in the second half of its run. Huh. So anybody who managed to watch all of it and watch all of it in sequence, they buy a lottery ticket.
Yeah. I want to revisit it because that was my first exposure to like actually watching a turtle show.
Yeah, me too.
Like I had never actually seen a turtle show, and I had just randomly watched it one day, and I was kind of like, "Huh."
Well, what you said is like this is the dumbest premise.
Yeah.
Well, when I was a kid, I was vehemently
it is the dumbest premise
the
though.
Entire franchise.
It's too many things. You can't have all four.
Although, like, okay, my summary of it has a lot of. It's very comic booky. Like a lot of its plot lines,
for better
you would find
or for worse,
in a comic
right?
book. And like if you like that shit, like it's good. It just like it takes itself a little too serious because it's trying to not be the '80s one that didn't take itself seriously at all a lot of the times.
Yeah, I remember catching that as a kid. Like this is really serious, but that was appealing to me because I was like 9. So,
like they, but then eventually they went into space more often. They went to the future for a whole season, and it just got insane with its own. It after 7 seasons, it started to get heavy under its own continuity.
That's
a lot of seasons.
Yeah, it's 155 episodes and a TV film where they crossed over with the '80s Turtles, but they got none of the '80s cast back, and apparently they treat the '80s Turtles with not a whole lot of love. They make fun of them a lot, and it's not deserved.
Oh. Well,
the homage in the 2012 series much more faithful, and I like it. But I would love to talk about the 2003 series if we can ever find the time for it. Like I did legitimately. I watched most of it. I would have watched it all if they made it easier to find, so I didn't dislike it. It's the best it's one of the best things 4 Kids ever put out.
Oh yeah, that's true.
Lot, but still.
Oh yeah, 4 Kids. Yeah. Right. Okay, and then Tyler Pollock said, do you think you would ever do Atlantis The Last Empire? Also, in terms of long-running shows, what you could possibly do is take a whole month off and just try and watch as much of it as you can. Just an idea. Love the show, guys. For the first one, I would be interested in doing it because that's my era of Disney films, which is probably the least beloved era of Disney films.
Well, it's more beloved than the Dark Ages.
Yeah.
Yeah. Second least beloved era of Disney
and
films.
Nobody knows the package era.
What's that era?
That's like Three Caballeros and Melody Time. That's the one that's all like vignettes.
I love Three Caballeros.
I love Three Caballeros. Let's do the Three Caballeros.
Yeah, I'm putting that on the list.
Atlantis we do. Like, yeah, that era of the post-Renaissance. Like, I love Lilo and Stitch. Lilo and Stitch is one of my favorite Disney movies.
Yes.
Yeah, we'll do pre and post Renaissance, but we're just probably not going to do Renaissance like we said in the last episode.
No need.
You don't need...
And I think there are interesting things to talk about that film, because I've heard a lot of people critique that it's kind of boring, or like there's doesn't really go anywhere, but I don't know. I remember really liking a lot of the characters and a lot of the art direction.
It was just
so
fun.
I think there are good things to talk about in that show and try to give it some sort of justice.
Absolutely.
As far as taking a whole month off...
That's not good. That's not good television.
Who are we? Gravity Falls?
I'm afraid we'd lose our momentum.
Yeah, momentum's absolutely important with this kind of thing. It's something like... Basically, with anything difficult I've done in my life, like be it a creative project or working out, if I lose momentum, I just lose all of it. So, we've taken a couple weeks off due to extenuating circumstances. Usually,
like
sickness.
4 weeks is out of the question.
I don't think it would be.
And
good.
Also, like, it's one thing to take a break because we're forced to, but if we were to tell our entire audience, "Hey, you're not gonna get us for a whole month," but then when we because we're going to do this one thing, all the people that don't give a shit about what we're taking a month off to do are going to feel alienated because they're being deprived of something only to be brought back with a product that they care nothing about.
Yeah. But what we're probably going to do if we ever do want to do a longer form thing is that we'll plan it a long time ahead and like we'll try to make sure, okay, watch like 10 episodes a week. And we'll...
When we actually get the hang of this show we're doing every week...
Yeah, that's the thing. Is that we're still having enough trouble watching, like, one show a week.
Yeah.
Yeah, and, you know, I'm, you know, a full-time student. I have a job. Nikki and Tooch. Nikki's full-time working. Tooch.
I hope to be.
Is full-time looking.
Full-time looking. He's at least part-time working.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's a little difficult, but we'll figure it out somehow. But thank you for your concern. Novu Inova said, "You guys should do the Steuben Universe thing sooner than later because it's super relevant right now and will boost your viewership, I bet." I agree with you. That is why we're doing Steuben next week.
Woo!
Hopefully that's not too late. I know how the internet works with these fads.
Well, it was just because, like, you know, we'd been promising Pepper Ann and then we had to take that week off and, there was a whole bunch of stuff.
But I'm sure it'll still be pretty popular because
it's
now so many more people like Steven Universe.
Oh, yeah.
Should we talk about who's going to be on that episode?
Sure.
That episode, since we've already talked about Steven Universe so much, the three of us, we figured we'd get in a additional voice. Our friend Kate, one of the voice actors from the collab and current head director, who will be joining us from across the Atlantic Ocean via the magic of Skype.
Across the pond, as they say.
Yeah, so she'll add some, she'll add her own commentary. You know, she's an actual, like, professional-ass artist, so she'll be able to talk about, like, visuals and shit and stuff that, like, we don't... At least I can't see, because I'm a simpleton. If you're a fan of the collab, she's the voice of Kanaya. In Let's Read Homestuck, I'm really looking forward to having this conversation with her. I've never, haven't had a opportunity to just really sit down and talk to her with this show.
And I'm looking forward to it too because we have talked about the show so much. It would be interesting to get another voice in on it. Especially since we've pretty much talked about each individual.
We've talked about almost every episode already. But we're still doing it because like it deserves it, and it'll bring in some traffic. Hopefully, that would be cool. Whatever though.
Charles Cooper just wanted to say that the fact that Tooch wrote the Peridot rap made him smile, and that made him happy.
Thank you.
And then Cranky Hermit was like, "I agree with Tooch. You guys should definitely consider using your Twitter more." All right then, Tooch. Why don't you use the Twitter more?
Honestly, I don't remember talking about the Twitter at all. I'll take you guys' word for it.
According to Cranky Hermit, you did.
Well.
I guess for our first initiative of use Twitter more, hashtag save Pepper
Ann. Hashtag unlock Pepper Ann.
Hashtag
unlock Pepper Ann.
Yeah.
at Disney. Everybody do it.
Everybody.
Okay, thanks.
I'll make that first tweet right now.
Do it.
Thank you. Because it deserves to exist in a way in which we can consume it. It's not fair that we can't consume it, nor can we pirate it. That's what really that's what really beefs me up. It's like, okay, you haven't made it available to us, but you're also deleting videos online. I'm like, what are we supposed to do? Do you just not want anybody to watch it? Like, what do you want, Disney?
Are you ashamed?
You had that cameo in House of Mouse, of all random places, with Pepper Ann and her mom.
Yeah, like, only her mom had that one line.
Because like, April Winchell was already hanging around to do Clairvoyant Cow.
Probably, yeah.
So get on that. That's everybody's homework assignment. Hashtag unlock Pepper Ann.
Would we do House of Mouse? I feel like if we did House of Mouse, that would cover all our opinions of Golden Age Disney along with it. Because like they're all in there. They're all like all they do is make fun of it. All it does is make fun of Disney stuff.
It's not out of the question. Where can people find us on the internet?
They can find us. Our main website is our Tumblr, thetoongoons.tumblr.com, where Nina curates this. A lot of official posts coming from the animation industry, a lot of concept art, animation tests, stuff like that, as well as, you know, where we post our episodes, we have an archive of our episodes, and we'll answer some asks that we feel is easier to just answer on the Tumblr than addressing on the show. We've got a Twitter, @thetoongoons, which, like, you know, we're going to try to use it more. An email address, thetoongoons@gmail.com. We upload all our episodes to soundcloud.com/thetoongoons, and they also show up on iTunes by searching The Toon Goons.
And we have a YouTube that has some videos on there, including some exclusive goof episodes, or maybe one, I don't remember, of stuff that we cut out.
Yeah, I've only managed to put up one Toon Goons so far.
Making funny goofs.
Stuff we have to cut out of the podcast, but it's still funny stuff, but it's off topic.
Yep. So, check us out on all of our platforms. And I want to thank everybody who has, in between the last episode, like, subscribed and started following us. Every week we get new people, and it just makes me so happy. I'm so glad that you guys are all on board. It really means a lot.
Yeah, we love you guys.
All right. So, yeah, next week, Steven Universe, you know, brush up on that. I've been Nikki.
I've been Nina.
And I'm Tooch.
Hey, Pearson. Nice podcast. There it is.